Hi everyone. Today I am at the University of Stuttgart with one of my colleagues, Cenk Bedera. Hi, nice to meet you. Nice to see you.
Nice to meet you.
So what we are going to discuss today?
Today we'll discuss about experimental physics and today's research in solid state physics.
Correct. And what we do here is basically the fundamental research. And what you know mostly is the application things, right? What we show. For example, we know about the light. We know about using X-ray in hospitals. But everything compresses down to the fundamental idea of how these electrons behave, right? For example, in this light, how we will get a light? These electrons move through the wires that heat up the system and that emits, or in case of LED, you have some excitations and that give rise to the light. And to understand that, we have to know the electron dynamics. And one of the main factors for understanding this electron behavior is law temperature. You know a lot about law temperature because he is doing the law temperature physics here with dilution refrigerator. How much you can go down to?
We can go down to 10 millikelvin.
10 millikelvin. That's near to the zero Kelvin, right? And why you want to go such a low temperature to see the electron behavior?
Yes, there are many effects that that you can only see when you go to low temperatures, because when you have, for example, at room temperature, there you have a lot of excitations because of the heat, the radiation coming in, electrons, particle movements. They do excitations, and then we can't see our effects that we're interested in, which could be superconductivity or magnetism. Mm-hmm. And if you want to research this, see this, then we need to go to low temperatures. This means sometimes, often, a few Kelvin.
Few millikelvin, correct. And you've mentioned about superconductivity. Maybe for the audience, can you quickly, just in 1 minute, explain superconductivity? That would be much better, right?
Yes. So superconductivity is a very interesting phenomenon. So many people know, if you want to have a current going through a cable, you need the plus and minus pole. You need battery.
The voltage.
You need voltage. A superconductor does not need this. The current can flow persistent without voltage. And this makes this, of course, interesting for technical applications. For example, energy transport without
losses.
Lossless
transport.
Only unfortunate thing is it occurs at very low temperature, a few Kelvin, sometimes a few millikelvin. Yes, but it's also a very interesting phenomenon. It's really, you can learn a lot about solid state physics, about what other people are interested in. Modern research.
Yes, yes. And this going to low temperature, then they will ask, why can't we figure out materials that can show superconductivity at high temperature? Right? That is one of the major questions. We have materials which show superconductivity at low temperature. Why can't we make materials that show superconductivity at high temperature?
It's very difficult. Okay, so when superconductivity was found, it was more than 100 years ago.
1911, yes.
1911. Yes, it was 1957 when it was then explained how this very low temperature, how this a few Kelvin superconductors work. And then some people found the 70 Kelvin superconductors.
High temperature
is still low temperature. You should not be confused. It's 70, 80, 90 Kelvin. Uh-huh. And these are not understood. And they are very exotic compounds, not usual things you encounter in nature. But they're really in a lab made. And people are actually really searching. They try to search for room temperature superconductor. Sometimes there are claims of room temperature
superconductors. Yeah, even recently there was something they showed, room temperature 295 Kelvin, and it was a flop. Mm-hmm. That's correct. And also, many universities are doing a really wonderful research on the superconductors. Apart from this idea of superconductivity, what else can we get out from these materials? I know your group is also looking for this granular aluminum for quantum mechanics.
Yes,
quantum,
you mean, now the point application. Is...
Instead of just looking at the superconducting properties, what other properties will show up in your materials?
You mean, superconductivity... Okay, superconductors are interesting from two sides, fundamental research and applications. Applications is not only lossless transport. Also, people think about building a quantum computer. Okay, this is something you always hear about.
The fancy picture of IBM hanging around the golden.
Yes, and there are also people think about superconducting quantum computers. Yeah. Superconducting because, okay, those quantum computers are very susceptible to all kind of losses, or it's very easy to harm those quantum states, yes, and yes. you need something robust. Mm-hmm. And of course, superconductor who does not show losses is then suitable for this. Yes, and that's for example, this granular aluminum. Huh? This is just aluminum, but it's granular. Okay, that's granular aluminum. And people found out that this is, for some reason, a very robust superconductor.
Mm.
And now people try to build a quantum computer out of this.
Yes, yes. And building, what are the challenges faced here? Is the limitation going down to the lower temperatures, or what makes us complicated? What is complicated here?
It is difficult to trap the photon in the in an oscillator. Okay, so you have an oscillator. It's usually
maybe you can just describe in a simple sense how an oscillator. You have one zero state and the
yes,
one
so,
state.
Okay.
And
you can make a Josephson junction. Okay, it's not suitable to explain too much, but you just have a superconducting device which can have state zero or state one. Meaning photon in or photon out. And if the photon is in, it can also escape sometimes.
Yes.
It's very difficult to trap. Sometimes
the stuff inside the state.
Just a few milliseconds, it's there, and then it's already gone. And then you try to do some calculations with it. It's very difficult.
Oh. And I also heard that if you have this state, even the neutrino or the muon radiation from the universe, right, that also affect the discrepancy of the system. How sensitive is this? It's very sensitive.
There was, for example, the talk by Johann Popp, and there he talked about it is eventually undermount to do the research, and then he found, okay, for some reason it worked, but it was also not yet perfect. Okay, it's really susceptible to all kind of effects, maybe even effects we don't understand at the moment.
Oh, and that is what these fundamental researchers do, right? We go all crazy properties to get rid of all the other effects. For example, temperature is just one of the effects we are dealing. We go low temperature to reduce this thermal fluctuation. That is just one factor. And there are many other factors. One is this radiation from the skies, right? So radiation from the universe. That can also affect the state, right? Okay. But anyway, this whole idea of going near to this quantum computation is very far, very fast. It's progressing pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
And how do you think, maybe comparing Germany, USA, or other Asian countries, how well Germany is doing in this particular standard, comparing the universities or the fundamental research that they're doing?
Actually, it's always difficult because when you're talking about science, it's somebody can make some, somebody can see something that was not seen before, and then there's a new exploration, and then the other people didn't know of this. Okay, but Germany is investing a lot of money in the quantum computers. For example, there was by the government a project to get one quantum computer in Germany, which the universities should then develop. I think compared to USA, France, China, Russia, and all the other countries where I don't know how much they invest, it's comparable, maybe.
But here the universities is really giving focus. There it is more the industries, right? The companies will... The independent researchers.
I know about IBM, Google, I hear this, yes.
They give a lot of money, but it is fast forwarding, right? Fast forwarding. And there are a lot of professors here. They really take care of this in very details, right?